And the founders of this institution would have found very bizarre if you could please turn off your cell phones. I'm Ellen Eisman, longtime trustee of the New York Society Library and longtime admirer as a layperson of Dr. Lieberman's work in the field of psychiatry. I've just finished his most fascinating new book, Shrinks, the Untold Story of Psychiatry, about which he'll speak this evening and take questions later. Dr. Lieberman's latest work traces the discipline of psychiatry from its confusing birth through to the science-driven profession it is today. A hugely ambitious undertaking, Shrinks draws you in with a key question: what is mental illness and how can it best be dealt with? Dr. Lieberman has gained his expertise on the subject through years of research and practice. He's a professor and chairman of psychiatry at the Columbia University School of Physicians and Surgeons, psychiatrist in chief at the New York Presbyterian Hospital, Columbia University Medical Center, and former president of the American Psychiatric Association. In 2000, Dr. Lieberman was elected to the National Academy of Sciences Institute of Medicine. Please join me now in welcoming a distinguished scholar, an accomplished author, and a prodigious contributor to our understanding of psychiatry, Dr. Jenkins.
Well, thank you very much. It's a wonderful opportunity to be here in such a beautiful venue to talk to you. Thank you for coming out on this evening. I'm going to talk according to the format for no more than 30 minutes, and then happy to discuss or answer questions on the book, mental illness, psychiatry, just not politics. So I went into medicine, being a good Jewish boy that was sort of programmed to become a professional, but not necessarily into psychiatry. And I got into psychiatry in medical school was something of interest during the early 1970s when really psychiatry was dominated by Sigmund Freud and psychoanalytic theory. And it was really over the course of my career, 30 plus years, that the field has evolved from what it was, which was kind of the runt of the litter, came to specialties in medicine into a scientifically based, full-fledged medical specialty, psychiatric medicine. And so I was really fortunate to have, in the course of my lifetime, much of these developments occurring and sort of experiencing firsthand, sort of like being witnessing history, whether you were in Vietnam or whether you were in any place where events were unfolding. But as I matured, aged, got more senior into a position of greater responsibility, it became painfully apparent to me that even though the field had changed so much and the way in which mental illness was understood and treated was so different, the old attitudes persisted. And as a result, the field of psychiatry is somewhat mistrusted, denigrated, and mental illness is not well understood and not optimally treated. So that kind of led me to do something that I'd never done before, which was to write a book for the public. So in the course of my career in academic medicine, you know, it's published in Paris, so you gotta do research, you gotta get grants, you gotta publish your work. And so I'd written several hundred papers for scientific literature, written or edited a bunch of books for professionals, but never anything for the public. And so I decided to try and write a book for the public to kind of cut through, or at least communicate what I thought was a truthful and coherent message about reality for anyone who was interested in finding out. And it should be most people, but that may not necessarily think that way. So what I'd like to do is to spend now the next 20 or so minutes talking to you about something that was really central to my motivation in writing the book, but in a different way than talking about the book per se or the usual book talks are done. And at the end, I'll come back to the book, and as I said, during the 30 minutes or so we have for discussion, happy to answer anything about it or anything else for that matter. So I want to start by asking a question. It's a rather personal question. I know we're just meeting for the first time, but indulge me. How many people here suffer from, or know somebody who suffers from a mental illness? So, when you think about it, your family, your friends, your classmates in school, your colleagues at work, your lifetime of experiences, most people should know, by personal experience or otherwise, someone with a mental illness. I don't want to put you on the spot, but that's the reality. I mean, if you just understand the available evidence and then you do the math. Now, I guess I should define what I mean by mental illness. So I'm talking about conventionally thought of conditions like depression and schizophrenia and dementia and bipolar and anxiety disorders. I'm also talking about intellectual disturbances like autism, learning disabilities, and ADHD, and also addictions to alcohol and drugs. So we're not talking about the worry well here, and we're not talking about problems of living. We're talking about something which is definable and thought to be sort of brain-based. Now, the World Health Organization, among other agencies that have done this kind of epidemiologic study, says that 20% of all people in the population will suffer at one time in their life from a mental disorder. And that's a pretty conservative estimate. But even so, that means 1 in 5, over 70 million Americans, over 1 billion people worldwide. And the fact that if you were to, I don't know if you watch Fox News, Waters World, or if you listen to Jay Leno's Man on the Street, or something like that, if you talk to those people, they would probably say, no, I don't know anybody with mental illness, I don't have mental illness. And the fact that so many people think they don't know anybody reflects three inconvenient truths. One is that there's not a good understanding of mental illness. Second is the fact that there's a considerable reluctance to acknowledge it. And the third is that mental illness is highly stigmatized. Now, stigma, you know, literally means, if we pull the dictionary down, disgrace or dishonor. And so it's like the mark of Cain in the Bible, or the letter A on Hester Prynne's dress in the Scarlet Letter, or the yellow star that was emblazoned on the clothing of Jews in Nazi Germany. Why should mental illness be so stigmatized? To show you how insidious it is, let's do a thought exercise. So imagine that you were invited to your boss's, or your boss's 50th birthday party, or your best friend's wedding. And you were asked to give a toast. On the day of the event, you got sick and had to cancel. So would you rather say that you couldn't come because you developed a kidney stone, or that you were depressed and suicidal, or that you threw out your back or had a panic attack, or that you were having a migraine, or you were strung out of prescription pain medication? Now, like most people, if you would prefer the former rather than the latter, you're affected by stigma. Now, there's no disgrace in that, nothing to be ashamed of, it's just the reality of what we have. And I mean, I experience stigma every day as a psychiatrist. The profession to which I've dedicated my life is the most distrusted and denigrated in all of psychiatry. I mean, in all of medicine. Apart from, you know, the anti-psychiatry people like Tom Cruise, who openly espouse these ridiculous notions and don't believe in mental illness, and they want to banish psychiatry. Well, I mean, have you ever heard of an anti-cardiology movement that wants to ban all heart doctors, or an anti-oncology movement that wants to prevent cancer treatment? groups and many of the anti-psychiatry constituencies believe that there's no such thing as mental illness, and they think that psychiatry should be banned and that it's dangerous. It's not just the anti-psychiatry people, it's also colleagues in the medical profession. We endure kind of slights and jokes and things all the time. I can stand here for the rest of the night telling you the kind of jokes and stories, and you know, at the center of any joke, there's always a kernel of truth. But just to mention a couple of the interesting, amusing, denigrated comments, I just read a couple of quotes. So Samuel Goldwyn, the film mogul, said, anyone who goes to see a psychiatrist ought to have their head examined. And there was another quote that said, the definition of psychiatry is the care of the id by the odd. The author of the Peter Principle said, psychiatry enables us to correct our faults by confessing our parents' shortcomings. And finally, there's nothing wrong with the average person that a good psychiatrist can't exaggerate and bill for. But if we thought about mental illness like we think of heart disease, then we would think of depression like chest pain, and anxiety like shortness of breath, and psychosis like an arrhythmia. So just like the latter emanate from the heart, former emanate from the brain. But the brain is infinitely more complicated than the heart or any other organ in the human body for that matter. I mean, the heart is basically a pump. It's four chambers, a dozen blood vessels, and 2 billion muscle cells to pump. The brain, on the other hand, is a 3-pound corrugated mass of tissue, which consists of over 100 billion neurons that form over 30 trillion connections and that are assembled into an intricate array of neural circuits that perform a myriad of functions simultaneously, including things like regulating your temperature, your breathing, your hunger, coordinating movements, focusing your attention, perception and information processing. And at the same time, it also forms your personality and who you are as a person. And the brain gives rise to your consciousness, whatever creativity you have, and it also houses the spirit. So how good is that? I mean, it's no wonder that we've just begun to understand the brain and how it relates to behavior and mental illness. And we've just really scratched the surface. Now, stigma is not unique to mental illness. I mean, it's been associated with many things, including diseases throughout history, leprosy, tuberculosis, cancer, plague. But in each case, research produced knowledge which led to understanding and then treatments, and ultimately the stigma dissipated. The best example that I know of reflecting that is AIDS. In the late 1970s, I was an intern at St. Vincent's Hospital in the Greenwich Village section of New York, and I remember the first cases of AIDS beginning to come in, and these people had horrible infections. We couldn't find any basis for it, and we had no treatments, and invariably everybody died. So if ever there was an illness to be stigmatized, this was it. But the fact that it occurred predominantly in two discriminated groups, homosexuals and intravenous drug users, made victims virtual pariahs. But then an amazing thing happened. The AIDS activists and advocates spoke out aggressively, they expanded awareness, they pressured the government into funding research, and within 5 years, 1984, two scientists discovered, they isolated the human immunodeficiency virus, the cause of AIDS. And then 3 years later, 1987, AZT, the first treatment, was introduced. And now AIDS is like diabetes. It's a chronic illness that can be managed, and you can live pretty normally as long as you get treatment. So contrast the outcome of, let's say, Rock Hudson, who was diagnosed with AIDS in 1984 and died within a year, to Magic Johnson, who was diagnosed in 1991. I saw on TV the other day, you know, he was leading a perfectly normal life, albeit, you know, taking appropriate treatments. So this is how science leading to knowledge and awareness leading to treatments not just helps people with alleviating the symptoms, but also really dispels the stigma. So with mental illness, we're still learning about the causes of the illness, but we do have an array of very effective treatments that are proven by experimental research and evidence. And these have helped millions of people. The treatments that are used are intended to alleviate the symptoms and the suffering associated with illness, and they do in the majority of instances. But in some instances, they do more than that. They actually transform a person's life. So just to give you one example, years ago I treated a patient who was a young mother. Let's call her Sarah. And she was a woman who had been housebound for over a decade and gone out of her house. But she had panic disorder and was afraid to go out, a condition called agoraphobia. And first I had to make house calls. So I went to her house, and she lived in this nice townhouse. She opened the door the first time, and she was standing there in this shapeless black tunic with dark glasses and long flowing black hair. And she looked like Morticia from the Addams Family. And so I began seeing her weekly, and I began with exposure therapy, and then gradually introduced medication. And within a couple of months, she was able to come to the clinic for her appointments, but she insisted on sitting right next to the door with the door open and her bicycle perched outside so she could dash and her bones and others if she had to. But then, eventually, she allowed me to close the door. She left her bike down in the lobby of the building. And within a year, she began going out with her husband, socializing with friends, and picking her kids up at school. When we terminated treatment, she came to her last session in a bright colored dress, new hairstyle, and she thanked me and she said, "I feel like I've been let out of jail, like I've been given my life back." Now, we don't have treatments for all disorders. Witness Alzheimer's disease and autism, and not all people respond as well as Sarah did. One condition that's particularly challenging and stigmatized is called borderline personality disorder. How many people have heard of that? So it's kind of a Rodney Dangerfield of mental disorders that doesn't get any respect. And the condition affects young people and it causes extreme mood volatility and self-mutilatory behavior and stormy relations with people. Behavior symptoms are so noxious that it drives away their friends and family, and even psychiatrists are kind of reluctant to treat such people. So one patient that I had with borderline personality was a woman named Lori, and she was in her early 20s, short hair, orange glasses, very quiet, but fragile demeanor, but she could explode into these volcanic rages, which would propel her into aggressive, hostile, or self-destructive behavior. And I worked with Lori intensively, seeing her several times a week, trying a variety of therapeutic approaches and medications, and it was some benefit, but really not very much. And by the time she dropped out of treatment, I felt like I really hadn't been too successful, and I really worried what was going to happen to Lori in the future. So we don't have effective treatments for all illnesses and for all patients, but there should be no question whatsoever that there is indisputably a world of difference between what anyone who has a mental illness would have faced throughout history and prior to the latter part of the 20th century and now. Because modern mental health care isn't perfect, but it's highly effective for a variety of treatments in most patients. So it's painfully ironic to me to from a mental illness, whatever the type it was, there's no hope. You know, I mean, you could get better on your own, but there was nothing that sort of modern medicine or healthcare could really do other than to support you while you were sick. But in the 21st century, the biggest barriers to treatment are not knowledge and treatment, the biggest barriers are lack of awareness, lack of access, and stigma. And so people suffer unnecessarily. I mean, imagine if people who had pneumonia or polio or any infectious disease didn't get antibiotics or vaccines. You know, this is a situation which exists with mental illness. Now, it's not trivial. I mentioned the statistics from the World Health Organization, about 20%. The World Bank has estimated that mental illness as a group of disorders by 2030 will be the most expensive group of disorders of any type in the world in terms of disability and cost. And if more isn't done to provide better mental health care, the global cost will be $6 trillion. So, what if there were no stigma? You know, how would things change? Well, I think that would give us the opportunity to launch a public health initiative against mental illness, like we've done repeatedly successfully in the past with things like infectious diseases, heart disease. The mortality of heart disease has dropped over 50% since when President Eisenhower had a heart attack in 1955. And also environmental toxins, eliminated lead, asbestos, smoking. But in order to be able to do this, we would need to do certain things which are publicly controversial now. So a key strategy would be early detection and intervention. Nip the problem in the bud before it progresses too far and causes too much damage. So that would begin with screening. So we do screening for blood pressure, diabetes, tuberculosis. We would screen. And we would screen in primary care settings like your family doctor or your OBGYN or your pediatrician, and also in schools, universities, and in the workplace. And people who were found to have some risk factors or symptoms could be referred promptly to clinics that specialize in the treatment of their condition. And of course, we have healthcare financing, which would support the treatment. And for people that are advanced stages of the illness that we now see, unfortunately, on the streets or in jails or in state of hospitals, there would be comprehensive community-based programs provided, medical management, rehabilitation, and residential facilities, so they wouldn't fall through the cracks, and they wouldn't end up in these places becoming eyesores. Of course, one of the issues there is that many people don't think they're sick and want any treatment, and that requires an issue about civil liberties and how much do we infringe on people's right to refuse treatment, hence the controversy. So if we did this alone, let alone all the other things that might be part of the strategy, this would have innumerable effects on many different people. And my wife told me not to drone on about these things, so I'm just going to mention very quickly the kinds of things that would immediately change. You know, the studies show that people who have depression suffer from an average of 7 years with symptoms before they get diagnosed and treated. That would continue. People that have psychoses oftentimes don't get treatment until they get so out of control that their families have to force them or the police take them to emergency rooms. PTSD, first responders, the military, there should be obligatory, not waiting for symptoms to be, but obligatory post-stress or trauma exposure treatment. Before the condition sets in, symptoms emerge, and the person has to make the decision, oh, do I admit I am a sissy and go for treatment? And first responders should have preventative and then decompression treatment before and after to try and inoculate them and then to alleviate the consequences once they occur. People people who are abusing substances should be encouraged and supported to get treatment as opposed to shamed and denigrated before they develop intractable addictions. It's known that one in four women will have a peripartum, pre or postpartum mental condition. Why isn't this routinely part of pre and postnatal care? And children, since learning disabilities are so prevalent, why can't we detect them early in school, not just provide remedial education, but provide cognitive training and emotional support so they don't get so frustrated and failing that they resort to antisocial behaviors and frequently end up in jail? So all these things would accrue. And you know, you might be saying to yourself, well, okay, this sounds pretty good. How much is it going to cost? You know, healthcare's costs are rising, and can we afford it? Well, health economists will tell you that the cost of healthcare would actually be dramatically reduced if we did be more proactive in providing mental health care. And families of people who have mental illness would be relieved of a lot of stress they endure and the cost of having a family member with mental illness. And also, the social problems that are so disturbing to us as a society would be either diminished or even prevented. And particularly here, I'm talking about the violence, the mass violence. So mentally ill people account for a small proportion of total violence in the U.S. But when it comes to these mass violent incidents that occur, there's a disproportionate number which are perpetrated by young males with untreated mental illness. And if you look at each of these cases, which I've done either by reading the news or in several cases consulting on these in one capacity or another, these people are symptomatic for months, in some cases years, before they commit their crime. But although they acted in distress, they were acting strange, they were socially isolated, nobody reached out to them. They were ridiculed, shunned, feared until they committed their crime. So this doesn't need to happen. So how can we stop the suffering, stop the violence, you know, stop the stigma? Well, I think to begin, we should be willing to recognize signs of mental illness like we do physical illness. So if the person next to you all of a sudden started choking or fainting or doubled over in pain, you would unhesitatingly turn to them and say, is something wrong or can I help you? But if they're acting weird, you're thinking, oh, you know, this is going to move my seat or it's not my business, or I don't want to intrude or what's going on. So we need to get over that. And we need to sort of exchange don't ask, don't tell, for I'm my brother's keeper. And you might say, well, I don't want to get involved, what's in my business, and so forth. Well, you know, what's the worst that can happen? You know, they say, I'm fine, nothing's wrong, or mind your own business, you know, you're too nosy. Well, so what? But the best thing that can happen is that you help someone to get help and alleviate suffering and potential harm to themselves or others. The other thing, because that will help those around us, but in order to try and expand this to like a population, we need to, either individually or through advocacy groups, get to the media and the government. Because they don't get it. And, or if they do, they don't act like they do. But make them realize that mental illnesses are medical conditions and that we have effective treatments and that these need to be made available to everyone, just like other forms of healthcare are. And frankly, this is the essence of why I wrote the book, you know, in a quixotic or masochistic effort to kind of speak out and say my piece and try and provide some accurate and reliable information in this sort of fog of misinformation and controversy, because it just wasn't being communicated in a reasonable way. And that's really how I came to write the book and speak on various occasions to individuals like yourself or audiences like yourself. So in this context, I have been writing articles periodically for op-eds or different types of blogs. And I wrote one after Robin Williams' death about suicide. And I got an email in response, which was titled, "Message from a Patient from Very Long Ago." And I'd like to just share that with you. "Dear Dr. Lieberman, last night I read your article about the suicide of Robin Williams, and I recognized your name. You probably don't remember me, but between the ages of 15 and 30, I was severely mentally ill with borderline personality disorder and depression. I made many suicide attempts and was frequently hospitalized. One of those times I took a large overdose and awoke in the intensive care unit of St. Vincent's Hospital. You were assigned to be my doctor, and I clearly remembered how very much you helped me. You probably didn't see it that way, as I know I gave you a hard time with my acting out and self-destructive behavior. However, eventually, with a lot of treatment, I was able to get myself together. I got married, enrolled in nursing school, and graduated as valedictorian. For the past 22 years, I've worked in psychiatric hospitals. When I look back at just how mentally ill I was early in my life, I would never have thought it would turn out so well. I'm very fortunate I feel to have a pretty happy life, and so I just had to let you know. What I remember most from when I was your patient is that you genuinely seemed to care about me and didn't judge me. But I suppose the best doctors were always the ones with the most heart." Signed, Lori. So this was the same Lori that I cared for so long ago with borderline personality. She had recovered. She had managed to overcome her illness, the stigma associated with it. And I was thrilled to know that she had really done so well and that my role may have contributed some small part to her recovery. But what really made what really struck me was the fact that what she sort of valued and remembered most wasn't my medical knowledge or my clinical skill, was that I cared about her, that I had compassion for her. And compassion is something that we all can do for other people, including people with mental illness. So while science and medicine sort of march on in pursuit of causes and cures for human illness, in this case mental illness, I encourage people speaking to, writing to, talking to, to join this process, to find the heart, muster the will, to reach out and to try and raise awareness and end stigma of mental illness. Because whereas in the past this was sort of beyond our reach for limitations of knowledge and therapeutic capability, it's not now. It's just the persistence of old attitude, just like prejudices occur with social issues, whether it's sexual orientation, or whether it's race, or religion, or whatever. So the same kind of prejudice and the healthcare disparity that this really instigates needs to be eliminated for mental illness as well. So I think that's all I wanted to say in terms of any prepared remarks, and I think we saved it in my time.
And my second question is whether you think that somehow in popular culture,
other media to Americans and other peoples to be made more aware of mental illness?
Yeah, great questions. In terms of the first one, so DSM is like the Bible of psychiatric diagnoses. It's called the Diagnostic Statistical Manual. It's started in the 1950s, and it's now in its fifth revision. When you say it has a larger meaning, what do you mean by that?
Well, I just meant that, you know, whether homosexuality has been included or not, or all kinds of big cultural issues that seem to be involved in what
I think what you're referring to is that it's become a topic of controversy in the public discourse, and that's part and parcel of the stigma. I mean, all illnesses, every kind of illness, you know, kidney, stomach, heart, everything, all illnesses are codified in what's called the International Classification of Diseases that the WHO puts out. And it's 11th edition, or 10th edition, going on 11th. And it has every disease, including mental illnesses. Nobody talks about the ICD, right? Have you ever heard of the ICD? Well, a couple of people, but, you know, so it's not the topic of public discussion or controversy, but DSM is. So what DSM is basically one of the, you know, few good things the American Psychiatric Association did in the early part of, or middle part of the 20th century was it realized that simply listing a name, schizophrenia, depression, manic depressive illness, and giving a number for billing purposes wasn't sufficient. There needed to be some descriptors which defined the symptoms of that illness to help clinicians define it. So they developed this DSM, which was really kind of a guide to expand or enhance the ICD. But it's become the topic of controversy for two reasons. One, because of the anti-psychiatry notion. Psychiatrists are pathologizing normal behavior, they're proliferating diagnoses, they're just trying to bill people for fictitious disorders, they're shills for the drug companies to push drugs on unsuspecting people, you know, ostensibly for these illnesses. And so it's become a feeding frenzy. And I was president of the American Psychiatric just when DSM-5 was being launched, and, you know, you wonder what it's like in the epicenter of media scrutiny when there's a controversy. You know, this was sort of like in the middle of it. And it's driven by controversy, by the anti-psychiatric skepticism of psychiatry. So that's the first reason. The second reason is that we have the dubious distinction of being a specialty that has as its area of interest mental illnesses. And all mental illnesses, there's 265 diagnoses in the DSM. All but two, there's no laboratory test to confirm it. It's all based on history, symptoms, observed signs. So there's no way to take an x-ray or a blood test or do an EKG to know if you have depression or if you're suicidal or if you're schizophrenic. And hence the importance of the DSM, because it provides this really detailed menu of a list of the symptoms. But the fact that it's all descriptive as opposed to it can be biologically defined or tangibly identified adds to this sort of suspicion and controversy. So those are the reasons. And the second question had to do with
common culture, the media.
Oh yeah. Okay. So if the general public had a very inaccurate and distorted view of mental illness, the media makes that look like a very balanced and reasoned view, but it's for good reason. There's two medias we're talking about. I'm talking about the news media and the entertainment media. Okay, so the news media is completely, except for Charlie Rose, the news media is completely irresponsible and culpable in doing nothing constructive and very much that's destructive about enhancing public awareness of mental illness. They just don't care, and they'll put on whatever they need to fill the airtime or get a talking head to talk about this and this topic. I've had a lot of experience with it, and I wish it was otherwise, but Even the holy New York Times. Is there anybody here who works for the New York Times? Related to the Salt Rivers? It's pathetic. It's pathetic. I mean, they publish inaccurate stuff or fluff, and they give very little editorial space to credible, accurate scientific information. There was one good article that appeared recently. Was that today or yesterday? Norman Ornstein. Remember?
Yesterday.
So there's a fantastic article by Norman Ornstein, who's in one of the think tanks in Washington, about his own personal experience with his son who had schizophrenia. But then 2 weeks ago, there was a scandalous article by a Cornell psychiatrist named George Akaris, called The Mind-Body Problem of Schizophrenia. And this was horrendous. It's like set psychiatry back 6 decades. So don't get me started. The entertainment media now has artistic license, right? So how can you blame them? So, you know, you've got Psycho, Dressed to Kill. Many people saw the movie Side Effects by Steven Soderbergh. Great movie. He's a wonderful director. Great, you know, Catherine Zeta-Jones, Jude Law. Fantastic. It was the biggest send-up of psychiatry. Everything bad about psychiatry and mental illness is in that movie. But then you contrast that with Silver Linings Playbook, which was very, very accurate and very constructive. Jennifer Lawrence and Brad Cooper. You know, this was Robert De Niro. This was really a very realistic portrayal. And Homeland, so lead character Carrie Mathison is CIA agent with bipolar disorder, and the motivation for that was the fact that the producer of the program, or one of the producers, has a sister who has manic depressive illness. So she included that in the character, and it's, my wife has said that movie's jumped the shark more times than the dolphins in SeaWorld, I guess. But the portrayal about her behavior, the medication she takes, has been pretty good. So, I'd like for the media, the entertainment media, to do more accurate and constructive stuff, like Terms of Endearment was a nice film, and there's several that have been good. I mean, much more scandalous and sensationalizing, but
Beautiful Mind.
Except that Ron Howard was sort of challenged. He was faced with a challenge of how do you depict cinematically hallucinations when these are going on as an interior experience. So he did it by enacting this fictitious thing with the Russians and with everything. And for somebody that treats people with psychosis all the time, it wasn't an accurate portrayal, but it was a good try. Sorry, did I answer the question?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Oh, yes. I mean, the saving grace of psychiatry. I should mention the fact we have a psychiatric royalty in the room, Myrna Weissman. Myrna Weissman is a member of Columbia faculty, but she was one of the groundbreaking pioneers in legitimizing psychiatry through scientific research. And she's also a neighbor. She's right next door, which is why she came. It's across town. She would have been here. Psychiatry is nowhere. And as my father used to say, it's better to be lucky than smart. In 1950, serendipitously, psychotropic drugs were invented. And following that, neuroscience began to emerge through imaging, genetics, molecular biology, and fields become revolutionized now through applying the scientific methodology to the study of the brain. But when you think about it, people think psychiatrists are weird or they're lazy or they're stupid. So the area of the body that psychiatry deals with and the illnesses are the part of the brain that was highly evolved in the entire animal kingdom, was complex in the world, and are the ones that are principally characteristic of humans. You can't do animal models as readily on these. So neurobiology had a huge impact. Now, in terms of our understanding of the pathological basis of developing treatments, it's going to, but hasn't quite yet produced diagnostic tests. But I think in the foreseeable future, there will clearly be blood-based tests, imaging-based tests, and neurophysiological-based tests. Yes, sir.
To what extent, Dr. Newman, are you confronted with the advance of neuroscience, but also a cultural lag within the profession itself that gives you a sort of a headwind for scientists who are trying to do double-blind random testing and getting a scientific model for treatment of specific disease, mental disease included? But is there, I get the impression there is a headwind in the profession itself that says, not really, and they hold to older ideas. This is true in other disciplines, like economics, for example. People hold to the balanced budget and things like that. Are you confronted with that academically within the profession itself?
Absolutely, absolutely. In that article I mentioned that it was in the Times 3 weeks ago, the psychiatry's mind brain project, a perfect example of it. It's largely generational. In other words, older generations. I mean, many people keep up with the literature and they adapt their views and their therapeutic approaches. But people who were trained in earlier periods tend to sort of perpetuate beliefs, and when you have findings that completely debunk something, it's hard for people to give it up. This Australian doctor won the Nobel Prize for discovering H. pylori as the cause of peptic ulcer disease, and before he proved it, he was vilified in his gastroenterology. So it happens, but it happens more in psychiatry. It's largely a generational thing, but the vestiges have not completely dissipated. They're still very much present. But the hegemonic control that the scientifically barren intellectual framework for psychiatry that existed for the first half and much of part of the second half of the 20th century has diminished substantially, but it's not gone away. Yes, ma'am.
So I have a question and a comment if I can make it. So my question is, what is the influence of vitamin D, the hormone of vitamin D, and also the microbiome in the gut and the flora balance, and how do you see those affecting mental illness these days? That's the first part of the question.
Well, vitamin D, apart from just the vitamin D, consequences of a vitamin deficiency is really not consequential to mental illness.
Not even the depression?
I'm going to go further than that.
Please.
You're on YouTube,
okay? There's been, and this is not just mental illness, this is all human illness. There's a extraordinary overvaluation and investment in complementary and alternative treatments like nutritional therapies.
I was talking about that. I was just talking about vitamin D and hormone.
Yeah. Well, vitamin D is not a hormone, so
it is. It's actually a hormone.
Vitamin D is a hormone?
Yes, it is. And what I want to do is I want to introduce you to Michael Hullock, who's the expert on vitamin D, and see what you can accomplish together. In terms of changing the stigma of mental illness in the world. Because, and the other thing I wanted to add, the microbiome is very important also.
The microbiome is a different thing.
That's an
emergent sort of construct for, you know, the physiology of the gut and how it has implications for human biology beyond just the gut and the digestive processes and eliminatory processes of the gut. There's a lot of sort of interesting speculation and some research on that. It hasn't sort of reached the area of influencing thinking about mental illness.
Well, actually, it has. The vagus nerve being the second brain, et cetera.
Yeah, but with all due respect, you're referring to people that have largely opinion. First of all, there's no secrets in medicine. There's no secrets in science. Anybody who has any belief, however cockamamie it might be, is invited to test that hypothesis, that theory, that belief. And if it can be empirically validated and supported, and then replicated by other people who don't necessarily have that theory.
I want to talk about that, you know, comment on the board. But, and I wanted to make a comment, if I might.
Please.
I think that I haven't read your book, but it sounds like a wonderful contribution. And you talk about, you know, it's a masochistic approach, and I don't see that at
What's
all.
What's a masochistic approach?
You mentioned that in passing, that, you know, you're being masochistic
right.
about this whole thing. And I don't think that, because if you want to actually prevent terrorism and you want to prevent these mass assassinations, I mean, this is really critical work.
Yeah.
And I think that if you can connect with people who are also in the same kind of mindset, who have other points of view or research that they can, you can share together, maybe then you can take it to the government, whatever, wherever else you can be as a leader in the world, because we really need you now.
Amen.
You brought up finances, and I'm wondering, has anybody, the healthcare financial experts, have they put an actual number on the cost that we incur as a society today? And have the cost of the screening through the treatment and the difference between the two?
Well, when health economists estimate costs, they have direct costs, and how much does it cost to treat people with sickness, and then they have indirect costs, you know, how much lost productivity or distress to others may occur as a result of it. The direct costs for mental illness in the United States are estimated annually to be like $90 billion. The indirect costs are some multiple of that. In terms of how much would be saved by better treatment, I don't think the estimates are that precise for it, and there would be two ways you would think about it. If you had better treatment services, you know, we were delivering the healthcare that we believe works more effectively, how much would it reduce the burden of illness and the cost of doing it? But then there's also the fact that if you look at overall healthcare costs, which have been rising for the past several decades now to the point that they're approaching 20% of the GDP, the two biggest cost drivers of that are end-of-life care and the costs associated with psychiatric comorbidity, meaning that people who are getting treated people who are receiving medical and surgical treatments who have some psychiatric disorder, along with people who have mental disorders, who develop comorbid medical disorders, that disproportionately is a much more expensive subgroup of people. They take longer to stay in the hospital, they get readmitted more times, they require more tests, more extensive treatment. If one were just to sort of guesstimate a percentage, you might say that total healthcare costs would be reduced if you provide a better proactive healthcare by as much as 20 or even 30%. Now, I don't know if the health economists, you know, precisely that, but, you know, I would sort of suggest that might be a thing. And so it's not just, you know, for humanitarian reasons, it's for economic reasons. You know, our country, the government of our country has a responsibility to defend us, you know, from terror and war. And the next most important thing is our economy. And the biggest threat to our economy is not Social Security. The biggest threat to our economy is healthcare. And so we're not acting in, you know, you mentioned economists, not acting in a way that I would think think economists would think logical. Plus, worse than that, the total U.S. budget is $4 trillion. Is that right?
That's about right.
$4 trillion.
That's about right.
The vast majority of all biomedical research is funded through the NIH. The NIH budget is $31 billion. So that's about 0.7%. So for the biggest threat to our economy and most effective way to control healthcare costs, or one of the most effective ways, biomedical research, we're spending like that much on biomedical R&D, whereas the European Union, Singapore, Japan, China, Korea are spending from 4 to 10% of their budget on biomedical R&D. So, you know, it's just, I mean, for those of us that work in the field of science and medicine, where you have to sort of go by the data and justify your ideas and statements, you know, it's like, who's running the show here? Very small. Yeah, the question is, what percentage of the NIH budget goes to mental illness? And it's very small. The per capita spend for cancer, for cardiovascular illness, for infectious disease, is multiples of what it is for mental illness. But if you go to Congress, I've testified before Congress a number of times, and if you go to Congress, you'd be amazed at what people think about mental illness. Yes, ma'am.
My problem with psychiatry is the tendency to over-prescribe medications, and irresponsibly. I'm not going to go through the whole detail, but I suffered from depression some time ago. I went to this doctor, and he prescribed all these pills. By the way, a lot of them were on the black market. And I got worse, and, oh, let's try another one. How did you try that? Now, no doubt he was sincere. Finally, I thought, well, I'm going to try analysis. Now, admittedly, it's a longer process, but it's dealing with the emotion. These problems are caused by certain stages you go through. You have to somehow have it work out. So this did work for me. I mean, I said, okay, I'll do it. I said, we can set a deadline, because I really didn't want this thing to drag on for my lifetime. And what we did was confront, we took time, but it worked. You're not just taking pills. And I felt, really, I wasted quite a few years with very strange things. One was worse than the other.
Well, I think, first of all, it's not either or. It's not medication or psychotherapy. You're absolutely right. You know, there's a lot of promiscuous prescribing done in psychiatry. But it's not just psychiatry, it's in medicine. Do you think that everybody who gets an angioplasty needs an angioplasty? Do you think everybody who needs arthroscopic surgery for degenerative joint disease in their knees needs do you think everybody that receives various medications they do need them? No.
But that's harmless. I don't do that.
You're getting
treatment you don't necessarily need, but it's not harming.
It is.
Well, surgery is pretty invasive, and an angioplasty is pretty invasive. But forgetting about that, that's not justifying the behavior. I mean, but I think doctors have succumbed to the pressures of the cost containment and the effort of reforming healthcare. They want to maintain incomes while reimbursement rates for insurance are going down, Medicare and Medicaid. And it's not good. It's not right. And it's really, I think, embarrassing or disgraceful for the profession. So there's good doctors and there's less good doctors, and we do this. And maybe there's more psychiatrists who are, less disciplined than others. So it does happen. Look at the number of people getting psychostimulants. Kids for age, everybody gets ADHD and stimulants now. Look at the number of antidepressants that are prescribed. But in your case, for somebody that has bona fide what's called major depressive disorder, psychotherapy alone, if it's severe, and again, Myrna is one of the world experts in this, she developed a technique of psychotherapy called interpersonal therapy. I should ask her to answer the question, maybe. But if you have severe depression, where you can't move, everything is black, there's no hope for you, you're suicidal, you can't sleep. Xanthotherapy alone probably was not going to be sufficient. You'll need a medication, but medication alone may not be sufficient. You'll probably need psychotherapy also. So it's like if you have diabetes, you may need insulin and oral hypoglycemic. But you also have to have some kind of behavioral management with your food, your diet, your exercise, you know, smoking. So with mental illnesses like that. So if you got better with psychoanalysis, that's fantastic. But it probably sort of speaks to the nature of the depression that you had, and also the kind of course of the illness. Because if you don't do a randomized trial, you don't know if you would have gotten better without doing anything in the meantime. I'm not personalizing it to you, but this is just the way science thinks. Myrna, would you like to add anything? You have to sing for your supper.
Well, there's very good evidence that there are efficacious psychotherapies that are evidence-based for the treatment of depression, and they work. And there's very good evidence that there's medication, and that usually the combination is better. The danger there is right now is that probably everybody in this audience, if they need psychotherapy, will be able to get it, mm-hmm. and will be able to pay for it. But whether there's going to be psychotherapy that will be paid for through the Affordable Care Act is really right now on the margin. And therefore, many people who go to their primary care doctors and have depression because they have some serious loss in their life and might benefit by 5 sessions of an evidence-based psychotherapy, they're not going to get it. Mm-hmm. And that's a real danger. And then the other danger is the fact that the funding for research is going down. And it's not keeping up with inflation, and it's not keeping up with anything. And we know how much time you and all of us spend trying to raise money, not for ourselves, but for research.
Thank you.
So what's the call to action? You said
government and media? Well, there's sort of 2 levels. One is, I think that, you know, as a society, we need to try and destigmatize mental illness so that if you are personally faced with a member of your family, with somebody you know, to show an interest in trying to encourage them to seek help because there is help for them. From the broader standpoint, there needs to be a way to mobilize the government to take a more enlightened approach to mental health care. Admittedly, you know, the chances are not all that great because we don't even have an enlightened approach to healthcare in general. But nevertheless, the reality is that if we did, a lot of good could be done. So the question is how do you sort of affect change in a society? And for some things, you know, like for ALS, for pancreatic cancer, for any conditions, you know, for rheumatoid arthritis, there are things are not going to get terribly much better until there's some new knowledge, some breakthrough that changes how we can treat the conditions. For mental illness, that's not the case. We've got, you know, we don't have perfect treatments, but we've got enough to help the vast majority of people who suffer from illness. I mean, autism we don't, Alzheimer's we don't, but for the majority we do. It's just that they're not available. I mean, if you have somebody that has schizophrenia, I'm getting hooked. If you have somebody who has schizophrenia, they need what's called team-based multi-element treatment. They need medication, but they also need to have some kind of case management. They also probably need to have some kind of supportive psychotherapy or cognitive retraining. They need to have residential support. They need to be able to connect with a primary health care so that they don't die 20 years younger than their non-epithelial peers, which is what the case is with excess medical comorbidity. But you can't find a clinic that provides it, and even if you do, their insurance doesn't cover it. It's like if you went to, suppose you had breast cancer and you went to Sloan Kettering and they said, well, you need to have a lumpectomy and then radiation and chemotherapy, said, but we can only give you the lumpectomy. Mm-hmm. That's the situation that exists. Thank you.